Muhammad Kakiika has taught for the last 26 years, of which 24 years are for the Cambridge program in and outside Uganda. Good to see you.
Good to see you, Brian.
I'm sure many OBs and OGs of Vienna are like, that's our headmaster. Well, when you look at the curriculum right now in Uganda, what's your make of it? You have a lot of experience, not just teaching here. Ideally, what do you see when we talk curriculum of Uganda?
Brian, thank you very much for hosting us, and good morning, viewers. Mm-hmm. Our curriculum, I cannot say it's not good. Mm-hmm. It has some components that are really very good, that are serving the purpose for which it was set up during those years, mm-hmm. Most especially the colonial era, where they were training manpower to do clerical job to ease the colonial administration. Mm-hmm. But frankly, I think the curriculum has lagged a little bit behind to produce the skills required for today's good employee or a good employer. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a little bit lacking, but it's not bad. It only required the necessary moves to transform it and make it ideal for the current situation.
I was talking to the Vice Chancellor of Victoria University. What are these skills that can make an excellent employee?
Our curriculum is not pulling out the best of a student. Yeah. That will enable them to get the required skills. It actually prepares someone to follow the instruction, to follow the instruction as given by the teacher, mm-hmm. that should a child or a student give an answer that is not what the teacher said, that's a wrong answer. And incidentally, this is manifested in the kind of trained graduates we have, that you always get perturbed, that lady or gentleman, I left this work and you didn't think out of the box on what to do. Because these people from the primary have been taught to repeat, re-echo what the teacher said. Mm-hmm. And then that's the bright student.
Yeah.
When he repeats exactly what you taught him, then he gets 100%. Mm-hmm. If he misses two or three, he misses the marks. Or if he gives his own views, then those answers are not correct. It's reflected even at the manpower rate. Mm-hmm. You always get astonished. You leave some work with a colleague, and then all of a sudden you'll be surprised that he did not think otherwise to do the thing better.
The curriculum does not train us to think outside the box?
Definitely. I can say that one affirmatively, that you are only expected to reproduce what the teacher, not even textbooks, mm-hmm. because I don't consider these pamphlets, mm-hmm. which are written majorly by teachers, with the 25 points, and every student must cram the 25 points.
I remember that.
To get the maximum points. Now, should you give any view, both in language or in text, that is not commensurate to what the pamphlet or what the teacher said, then you are wrong.
Right.
But in real life, things are not like that. Mm-hmm. Every client that comes to you as a banking officer or as a journalist is different. Mm-hmm. So one client might be so demanding, he's asking you to give him 50,000 notes. When you give him, then he says, who told you that I don't need the 10,000? Now this person you'll see completely lost, mm-hmm. because he has not been trained to accept views as they come, and then you use your intellect to come up with the right solution to the problem.
Mm-hmm. Yes. You've been teaching, for many years in and out of Uganda. The curriculums that you've been exposed to, how are they different here? That you have that, we're always told, even when you talk to educationalists, they tell you we have to change our curriculum. One of the presidential candidates is saying kids must learn up to lunch. That's what I'm going to do if you elect me as president. And we still tell him we didn't turn out badly. We use that. You didn't turn out. You use that curriculum. How are they different from here?
Incidentally, the majority of the presidential candidates did not study under our current system. Mm-hmm. I would correct you on that. I think a few of them only those who are 50 years and below are the ones who studied under our current system.
So you'll take Mabiliza and Charia. President Museveni studied in Dar es Salaam.
Cambridge, no. Yes. Museveni studied the Cambridge system.
Right.
So is Amanya, so is Dr. Kebi. Mm-hmm. All of them did not study under the local, current local curriculum. Mm-hmm. They studied under the Cambridge system. I'm on record. You can read the president's...
Sowing the mustard.
Yeah, I sat my Cambridge exams in this year and passed as follows.
Yeah.
So the bulk of the presidential candidates really actually studied under the Cambridge international system.
Mm-hmm.
And the ones who are current right now are yearning to change. Probably they are seeing that they cannot match the people who studied under the other different
system.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So incidentally, if you say the Ugandan education system, up until around 74, we were doing Cambridge exams. We shortly did the East African Examination Council before the East African Community collapsed. And that's when we moved into our own, say, the Uganda National Examinations Board.
Mm-hmm.
But incidentally, all our other previous study and education system was a Cambridge system, which its products, you know, how many new professors are we churning out of recent? But you look at the other old, renowned professors, you know, Chiria, Wire, those neuroscientists, surgeons. You know, we are actually lucky. The Ugandans went to NASA to work on two of the space ships. That was then when the education offered was really getting out the best from the child, but not only to post exam results onto the mark sheet. Until the certificate, you know, you really see these young children going through primarily an extremely rigorous system to get 96%. A 12-year-old to sit an exam for 2.5 hours, all three.
That's too long.
Incidentally, what do you expect of this child when he's done with that exam paper? That's why we forget and leave everything that we studied at the universities,
mm-hmm.
all at the secondary school levels, because it is a grueling punishment.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you do not expect a 12-year-old has that paper in the morning and another one. But there are some other education systems that recognizes that this is a 13-year-old,
mm-hmm.
should be assessed up to this level. Exam papers should move. Cartoons should be there to encourage them to read through the passage as they're enjoying it.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So really, we've been prompted to come and help our public to really understand that there are some alternative education avenues available.
You know, I was talking with a friend yesterday, actually, on Sunday, and he was, you know, his child is starting school, and he was very worried. He said, "But school is actually hard. I can't believe that my child is going to go through the next 20 years in school." You say that the Cambridge system has some similarity with the UNEB system. What are some of those similarities? That
actually not some. The current Ugandan curriculum is 100% University of Cambridge Local Examination Syndicate curriculum. When we broke away from the East African community, Uganda found it better to go back to its original parent, because the education in Uganda is not actually a British curriculum.
Mm-hmm.
It is the University of Cambridge Local Examination Syndicate. Because in 1902, when Sir Paul Kagwa went to England to solicit for education for the Ugandans, he was taken around so many education institutions in the UK.
In the UK.
Oxford, and he went around. He was greatly impressed when he got to Cambridge University, especially the King's College,
mm-hmm.
which is an education faculty of the Cambridge University.
Mm-hmm.
Incidentally, the current King's College, Budo, in Uganda, is not Ugandan King's, not mm-hmm. Buganda Kabaka King's,
mm-hmm.
no. It's a replica of the King's College in Cambridge.
Yeah.
5 rugby grounds, so many facilities, imposing structures. That's what Paul Kagwa asked for to be given to Ugandans. So the University of Cambridge was given the mandate to look for a suitable education system for the colonies. We were lucky in Uganda that we were picked on, or we picked on Cambridge. Kenya did not go for Cambridge. I think in Africa, a few colonies, or in the world, a few colonies, Basutoland, currently Lesotho, got the same Mauritius, Singapore, we have a similar education system. This process of primary, secondary, A levels, university honors degree is a function of the British curriculum, but particularly the Cambridge University.
You want to switch that up a bit. How are you planning? How will this still be brought here and still bring out the holistic person that you know, that the system provides, that the Cambridge system provides?
The only issue, truthfully, is that the system that locally we are running is an HD Cambridge system. I will not mention the year to which we are still stuck. And I want to tell you that Cambridge has moved from that level, has moved
forward. They recognize that.
Yes, they have moved now. The papers that we are doing start with 1, 1, 2, 1, 1, 4, but they are now on 5, some are on 9. You cannot offer ICT instruction now, which, you know, which was of the late 70s. So now, incidentally, our curriculum's biggest bottleneck is having failed to be developed, as the demands for the society, demands for the employers and skills requirement is concerned. Mm-hmm. You can't do anything at the university. I sympathize these universities that we are agreeing that they are producing
quality.
Half-baked.
Right.
They are just inheriting a problem. The problem starts with primary four, when the kid is given a lot, and it's an issue of how much you have put into your head, not how much
at
you
that
can
age.
Digest. The Ugandan curriculum is 100% a Cambridge one, because when I look at the examinations that are set in the local, because I taught it, I marked it, I can look at similar papers that are there in the Cambridge program. And incidentally, when we talk about international, the only examining body or education system that is 100% compatible with the Ugandan one is the Cambridge. Because there are many examining bodies. There is the International Baccalaureate, there is the London GCE, EdExcel, OCR, RSA, in UK, and also here. So you can only be sure the one that is fully compatible with the Ugandan curriculum is the Cambridge. Mm. Now, the issue where the Ugandan one cannot fit in very well is that the others have moved to assess students based on to an individual ability, but also basing on to the realities that the demands are different. Mm-hmm. In Cambridge, there are many multiple choice questions. Locally, they are not in some papers. Almost all papers have that. In Cambridge, a child can be based according to assessment, you know, coursework based. But during our times, we had coursework-based assessment. Mm-hmm. I did my geography paper 3, was a coursework, field work. And
really?
I submitted, yes. And I went to the field. I worked onto a banana, a potato plantation in Lukaya, Narutaya Estates. I still remember vividly asking. So geography, we had field study, coursework-based assessment, and contribute towards your final grade. There are some children who have examination fever. Under the current circumstances, you are doomed. Because if you can't pass the exams,
you're right done.
You are done.
Yeah, we always complain about how this one exam can literally determine your future. And some people don't like it. Mr. Kakiika, I would like us to continue this conversation, because it's a very interesting conversation. Go to our Facebook page, Morning at NTV, and tell us what you think about the current curriculum and how we can revise it. We'll definitely ask Mr. Kakiika to come back and talk more about how we can streamline the curriculum here in Uganda so that we can bring out fine and quality students. And on this show, we've been on record to talk about how unemployable our young people are. How can we create employable people in the future? That conversation will continue on Twitter and Facebook, and we'll have you call in next time to contribute to this conversation. In parting shot, Mr. Kakiika, before we let you go. Well, I was going to ask you about Vienna College, but that's advertising. You'll have to pay for that. Please. Well, let's take a breather. When we come back, we will be talking sport. Derek and Darren will be here.